Global Plan for Cardiff University, and Andrew Williams, Dr. Andrew Williams, lecturer of the School of Global Plan. And they visited High School of Economics, the Institute for Regional Studies within the Academic Mobility Program, Erasmus, and now Paul, firstly Paul and then Andrew, present their open lectures. So you could see the chat. So, Paul.
Okay, thank you. Okay, dobro jutro. It's delightful to be here at the university and in Moscow on such a beautiful day. I'm going to talk to this title on the screen, but I just want to warn you, this is a paper that is being developed. It is an early draft of some ideas, and it's under development for two reasons. One, because this thing called Brexit is associated with a great deal of uncertainty. We don't know what is going to happen generally and in relation to the agri-food system. And secondly, what I'm going to talk about today is based on research and field work that is ongoing. And it was only yesterday on the plane and last night in the hotel that I was looking at transcripts from the interviews for the first time. So in the paper, what I want to talk about is, first of all, Brexit and what that means, its background and what has happened, and particularly make a connection between Brexit, the decision by British people to leave the European Union, and migration within the UK. Then I want to look at the role of migrant workers within the agri-food system in the UK, give you some figures, some statistics, but also some experiences of migrant workers within the agri-food system. Then I'm going to tell you about the work we're doing at the moment, trying to understand what Brexit means for the future of the agri-food system in the UK. And I'm going to talk about two different narratives, two different discourses. One, that Brexit is the worst thing that could happen in terms of agri-food, that it could lead to a collapse of the agri-food system, a crisis of the agri-food system. And a second narrative, one that is based around Brexit offering new possibilities for a different type of food system within the UK, a fairer type of food system, one that is focused much more on local and national issues rather than international ones. So let me begin with my most colourful slide of today, Brexit. And let me take you through what I think happened over the last year or so within the UK. Membership of the European Union has always been an issue for one of our political parties, the Conservative Party, the party that is now in government. There has always been internal tensions within that party about whether we should remain in the European Union or we should leave. When the Conservatives got into government last year, or 2 years ago, in 2015, within their manifesto was a commitment to hold a referendum on whether the UK should remain within or leave the European Union. That referendum was held on the 23rd of June last year, and by a margin of 52% to 48%, the British people voted to withdraw from the European Union. Things started to happen very quickly after that, in that the day after that decision, David Cameron, the UK Prime Minister, resigned. and a new Prime Minister came into power, Theresa May. And what Theresa May did quite recently, on the 29th of March of this year, was deliver a letter to the European Commission stating that we were leaving, triggering something called Article 50, which gives the UK and the European Commission 2 years, 24 months to negotiate a divorce settlement. And as you can see, we're very early into this two-year period, so we don't really know what is going to happen. But I will try and take you through some issues and some different scenarios. So let's look at this vote. You can see the red are areas that voted to leave, a majority voted to leave. The blue areas that decided to stay. And the first point to make from this slide is that England, Wales voted to leave, Scotland voted to stay, to remain, and Northern Ireland also voted to remain. And you can see in terms of London, almost all of London voted to remain. When you look at the map on the other side of the slide, you can see that there are concentrations, or the highest proportion of people voting to leave are in particular areas. And you can see there are concentrations in this sort of area, in particular towns and cities, and down here. And these sort of things here, these sort of areas here, maybe going to the southwest of England, will become more important as I talk about some of the reasons for leaving. If we try and break down the voting patterns by geography, what you'll see from this slide is that a majority of people in rural areas voted to leave. In the smaller towns and cities voted to leave, but in the big cities, London and other big cities, a majority voted to remain. And when we look at this second table here, what I guess people from the UK would notice here is that several of these areas are very rural and dominated by agriculture. Here, 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 and here. And we look at the other side of the table. 8 out of 10 of those areas are in London. The other two are big university cities, Oxford and Cambridge. So that's what the voting patterns look like. But what ran through the referendum debate, what was a very contentious issue, was migration. And what we found was that a particular politician by the name of Nigel Farage, who led the UK Independence Party, was very much using migration as a reason to leave the European Union. This was a very controversial poster because what it shows is not people moving from the countries of the EU into the UK, but these are asylum seekers, refugees moving from other parts of the world through Southern Europe and creating a little bit of a crisis for the European Union in terms of how to deal with the issue. But this very, very strong narrative of Britain being at a breaking point, we need to reinsert our borders, that migrants were causing problems, there were too many of them, they were putting pressure on our public services, they were damaging community cohesion. So let's move away from that contentious poster to look at some of the statistics to do with migration within the UK. This gives you that long-term perspective from the beginning of the 20th century through to the present day. And you can see that for many, many decades, fluctuating between small net losses and small net gains. And then when we move into the 1990s and into the new century, something begins to change. We can see this from another set of statistics from the 1960s and onwards. And again, you start to see something happening in the 1990s, where immigration begins to get much higher, and net migration, the number of people moving to the UK minus the number of people leaving the UK begins to increase quite significantly in the late 1990s into the 2000s. When we compare the situation in the UK to that in other European Union countries, you can see Germany made a big statement about taking migrants over the last few years, but Germany and the UK seem to be in a different position to other countries within the European Union. And when we break immigration down to British European Union citizens and non-European Union citizens, you can see again that the growth in migration is largely associated with increases in EU citizens moving to the UK over the 2000s period. Now, a key reason why this has happened is because in 2004, the EU8 countries joined the European Union, and more recently Bulgaria and Romania have joined. And the UK was one of only two or three countries that in 2004 took the decision not to limit, not to restrict the number of citizens that could move from these eight European countries. And you can see what happened. The government underestimated the number of workers that would move to the UK, and you can see every year since then more than 50,000 people a year from those eight countries that moved to the UK. And more recently, migrants from Bulgaria and Romania in 2012, you can see again a significant rise there. And when we look at the most common nationalities in the UK, this is the latest data for 2015, you can see now that people from Poland are the largest number and increasing. You can see migrants from Romania, or citizens from Romania, beginning to become more significant. And to give you an example of the types of increase that we're talking about, when Polish citizens were permitted to move to the UK in 2004, there were 69,000 in that year. The last year, 2015, for the data, 916,000. A 13-fold increase across those 11 years. And the same with people from Romania, in the first year, 98,000, rising 4 years later to 233,000. So in terms of migration becoming an issue, there was the political rhetoric being used by Nigel Farage, but there was something happening within the UK across this period. And what we see from this slide is that the bulk of the increase in migration of people coming to the UK relates to those people moving for work. Very little difference in terms of people coming to study, to accompany family members across this period, but a massive increase in terms of those people coming to the UK to work. So they're coming to work, but they're coming to do particular types of work, and most significantly, they're coming to do work that pays less than the average wage level for people in the UK. That's the average for the UK, for the EU 14 countries, but you can see here for the EU 8 and Bulgaria and Romania, much lower wage levels. There's also, back to that point I made earlier on, an interesting geography to where migrant workers from the EU began to settle. Conventionally, when migrants move to new countries, they tend to go to the larger cities and then move from those cities into other places. But for migrant workers from the EU 8 countries, a slightly different pattern emerges. So yes, cities like London attracted quite a lot of migrants, and these cities also, these other cities did. But you can see from the dark shading that other migrant workers move to predominantly rural areas. So rural areas of Scotland. This is an important area, given what I showed before on the slide. That was where highest levels of voting to leave the EU were taking place. And what we find is migrant workers are spread out across the UK in towns and cities, but importantly, in rural areas. And one of the reasons they're moving to rural areas is they're moving into particular sectors of the economy. Agriculture is one, and food manufacturing, food processing, food manufacturing being another. And again, you can see how these numbers of migrant workers moving into agriculture have increased over the last few years. And you can see in terms of food processing and food manufacturing how that is a really significant sector for migrant workers to be based in. So movements into small towns and rural areas in the UK, movements of migrant workers into agriculture in terms of working in fields, as well as the manufacture and processing of food products. Now, one of the reasons why migrant workers are moving into agriculture is that farmers in the UK are finding it difficult to recruit workers into the sector. And there are a number of reasons that are often cited for why UK workers do not want to move into agriculture. One, it's unattractive or very hard work. very intensive work. Two, it's not necessarily full-time work across the year. There's a seasonal aspect to it. Three, this work often takes place in remote locations. There is a need for workers to be very close to the farms, to live on the farms or close to the farms. And finally, wage levels are relatively low. Relatively low in the UK context, but when we look at agricultural rates of pay across the European Union countries, you see that yes, Scandinavian countries are recording the highest wage levels in agriculture with the Netherlands and France there. But the UK is there. And you can see, you can see some of the countries we're talking about here, in terms of Romania, Bulgaria, and Poland. So wage levels in agriculture, low in the context of UK wage levels, but much higher in the context of some of those countries in Central and Eastern Europe. And there are particular sectors of food production that are much more dependent on labour than others. So horticulture, the production of the growing of vegetables, and production of fruit being two in particular, where there's a very, very heavy emphasis on labour. And labour costs are a very important part of the production process. So, just moving on a little bit to try and summarise what I've been talking about there. Some work that's been done in the UK has pointed to the increased significance of migrant workers for the economy of the UK as a whole, but a particular significance in the context of agriculture, where migrant workers are seen as very, very important for the production of food, mainly because British workers will not enter that sector. But, and this is where it gets a bit more interesting, another reason why migrant workers are required within the UK agri-food system is related to the changing relations between farmers, people who grow the food, and people who sell it, and supermarkets in particular. And there's been a lot of people talking about the ways in which the supermarkets are driving the structure of agri-food within the UK, that there are top-down pressures being placed on producers. And as Ben Ruggley talks about, the supermarket governance of the chain through the language of quality is fed through into a demand by growers for particular qualities in the workforce. In particular, he says, workers of a sort who will be reliable, flexible, and compliant. And for the growers we interviewed, he says, all these qualities were seen as more likely to be found in foreign workers. So what we find within the UK agri-food system is this idea of intensification taking place through innovations within the workplace, through changes to modes of working, to becoming more flexible, to have workers who are more compliant, and in that sense, migrants from other countries are seen as good workers, people who are prepared to work for lower wages, prepared to work for something called zero hours contracts. Contracts that could be 60 hours, 80 hours 1 week, and 10 hours the week after. And increasingly, piecework, something called piecework, coming into the system. So it's not about a minimum wage that you get for an hour's work. You have to produce or pick a certain, certain amount of food to qualify for that payment. So about 3 or 4 years ago, we were commissioned by the Welsh government. We're based in Cardiff in Wales, to do a piece of work looking at the changing position of migrant workers within the country. So we did lots of things. We analysed what official data was around. We did lots of interviews with key stakeholders. We did a survey of migrant workers in different sectors, and we followed that up with some interviews. And this was a project that was looking across different sectors of the economy within Wales, so agriculture and food, the care economy, social care, and other sectors also. And what became apparent fairly soon within the project was that migrant workers were dominated by people from Poland. As I showed before, within the UK, it was the same in Wales, and that most of the Polish migrant workers we were encountering were in the agri-food system, and more particularly were working in the meat processing sector, abattoirs being the most common form of work. So we decided to do some further work, some follow-on work, looking at migrant workers within the meat processing sector in Wales. And it was the same set of issues that I've talked about in the previous slides. The increasing power of the major supermarkets within the UK, exerting pressure on the growers, the farmers, producing the food and the processors below them in the supply chain. Farmers coming up with more flexible modes of working, passing the uncertainties that they were working within to their workforce through those things I talked about before. Low rates of pay, flexible contracts, and more migrant workers. And as the European Union expanded in 2000, so more and more migrant workers became available. So we started to do some work on this in Wales, trying to explore what it was like to be a migrant worker in this sector of the agri-food. And the first thing that we noticed was it was incredibly difficult to find migrant workers within the meat processing sector, because a lot of these what are now factories are based in places that make them invisible, and we talk about this in a paper we wrote from the project, that we were talking about very much migrant workers who were outsiders, who were cut off from the rest of society. They were working in places that made them difficult to access. These factories were dislocated from place and from community. They were located on the peripheries of urban centres and rural towns. When we did start to talk to migrant workers involved in meat processing, we then began to pick up on some of the experiences of working within this sector. The first issue we encountered was the ways in which, yes, Polish workers were present within these factories, but so were other nationalities from the European Union and people from Portugal in particular. And the ways in which different nationalities were being played off against each other. There was a competition to be the best or the hardest workers within these factories. As I mentioned before, this thing called zero hours contracts was a very strong aspect of working within these places. Workers afraid to turn their phones off because if they missed the call to come in for work, then they could risk losing their jobs. And this issue I mentioned before, they could be working 7 days a week and they could be waiting for days and days for the next piece of work. This was the expectation. Flexibility was the expectation amongst the workforce. There was very little protection for migrant workers, very little union representation. When certain groups of workers tried to join trade unions to protect themselves, they found they were without work. They were no longer employed by particular companies. We found a lot of people moving across who were overqualified, had been in higher education, but were just looking for any type of job to move to the UK. And several incidents of abuse within the workplace. So we came to the conclusion within this work that migrant workers were largely detached from place, from local society, local community, for a number of reasons, most notably in terms of their patterns of work, working on sociable hours, making it difficult for them to mix, but also within the factories, working amongst fellow workers, there wasn't a requirement necessarily to speak English, to learn English, and so socializing amongst their compatriot workers. Where we did see some slightly different issues was when Polish migrant workers were moving across and using food enterprises, new food businesses, restaurants, food shops, delicatessens, not only sell food to migrant workers, but also using food to bring others from places and the community into restaurants, into shops, and to experience the cuisine, the food of other countries. And we've written this work up, if you're interested, in a couple of papers. Okay, moving on to the present. This is the project that I was talking about a few minutes ago. This is a project working with a couple of colleagues of mine within the School of Geography and Planning, Gareth Entercott and Kevin Morgan, funded by the UK's main Research Council for the Social Sciences. And what we're trying to do is look at the future of the agri-food system in relation to Brexit. So we've been looking at the ways in which food and Brexit have been talked about within newspapers, the ways in which different groups are writing articles in the newspapers. But the main part of the project has been interviews. I think we've done about 40 interviews so far with different organisations, different stakeholders within the agri-food system. So within food production, food processing, animal welfare, labour suppliers, government and retailers. Now, unfortunately for us, when we were halfway through the interviews, the Prime Minister called a general election within the UK, which will take place on June the 8th. That means that you're not allowed to talk to anybody in government until the general election is over. So we've had to hold a little bit on this until the end of the general election. And what we're hoping to do then is to bring lots and lots of people together for a couple of workshops to try and take things forward. Okay, so the first thing to say is that very, very soon after the Brexit vote, people began to talk about key changes within the agri-food sector. The immediate thing that happened when the vote to leave had been verified was the exchange rate for the pound changed dramatically. It fell by 20-30% against the currencies. It fell against the euro, it fell against the dollar. Why is that significant? In terms of falling against the euro, overnight, literally overnight, EU migrant workers were receiving the same amount of pay in pounds and sterling, but that was much lower in terms of what that meant in terms of euros. And that was important because a lot of migrant workers send money home to their families. In terms of the fall of the pound against the dollar, that was very important because a lot of food in the UK, as with many countries, is imported, and the dollar is often the key currency for those imports. So what has started to happen, and I think we're all seeing this in terms of buying food in supermarkets in the UK, is the price of imported foodstuffs is increasing. Price of buying food in the UK is also going up. That was the first thing. The second thing, what the people who voted to leave were wanting was the end of the thing called the European free market. They were trying to move away from the free movement of goods across the European Union countries, and importantly, the free movement of labour. Thirdly, the UK receives something like 30 billion euros of subsidies through the Common Agricultural Policy. There was doubt about what would happen to that money. £30 billion of money going into the system, when at the moment within the UK and the last few years in the UK, policies to do with austerity have been imposing significant cuts on public services within the country. And then finally, there was a great deal of uncertainty surrounding the position of EU citizens within the UK, and there still is that uncertainty about whether those EU nationals currently in the UK will remain in the UK following the Brexit. So what we've been trying to do within our research, and what I'm going to try and show you over the next few minutes, are some of the themes coming out of the interviews with the key stakeholders within our project. One of the strongest themes that comes through our interviews, and this may not surprise you given what I've been talking about in this paper, is the very heavy reliance that the agri-food sector has on migrant labour. So this representative of the National Farmers Union talks about migrant labour is as important ingredient to horticulture as sprays and fertiliser. Without it, we simply could not, as an industry, produce the volume of crops we do today. And it goes beyond horticulture, production of vegetables and potatoes and those sorts of things, to other sectors to do with poultry, dairy and livestock, and also into the processing sector. So in terms of some statistics coming out of our interviews, in terms of the UK pig industry, more than half of all farm businesses using migrant labour. In terms of fruit and veg, you can see there we estimate 80 to 90% of people picking and packing and processing coming from countries of the EU. And people have started to talk about this in quite stark terms of the UK literally running out of food. If you took migrant workers out of the supply chain, you would within 5 days have no fresh produce on supermarket shelves. But migrant workers in the agri-food sector need to be seen as important as those working in the financial services. If you can't feed the country, you haven't got a country, as this person says. And so what is going on, and what began fairly soon after the vote in June, is that the big players within the agri-food sector, in this case the National Farmers Union, trying to engage with government to negotiate an exemption from limits on migration within to the UK. That the industry just cannot survive without this volume of migrant labour moving into it. Other issues that are beginning to be identified is or are some of these uncertainties about the future of EU citizens within the UK. So not knowing what's going to happen in the future, finding it difficult to recruit migrant workers from EU countries given this uncertainty. And all that negative press coverage we had of migrants, migrant workers, and migrants being part of the problem, creating problems in the UK. All that negative publicity going around the world and putting doubt in people's minds about whether the UK is a good place to come at the moment as a citizen from Eastern and Central Europe. As I talked about before, there were some immediate financial impacts of Brexit for migrant workers in terms of the exchange rate changing dramatically. What certain people are talking about now is that with that exchange rate change, other countries in the UK, in the European Union, become more attractive financially, Germany, the Netherlands, to migrant workers. And so what we're beginning to hear from particular people is that the number of migrant workers could be decreasing, a more limited pool of migrant labour, particularly from the countries of the East and
Central Europe. This is one of the big labour suppliers talking about the ways in which the number of people they're able to find to come to the UK has declined somewhat. In certain cases, we were picking up a different narrative in terms of the relationship between farm business or labour supplier and migrant workers. That there were certain labour suppliers who were doing more interesting things with migrant workers, trying to use the experience of migrant work in the UK to provide benefits not only to the farms but also to the migrant workers themselves. So offering English language lessons, offering other educational facilities, trying to engage them in sport and community development, trying to see this as a two-way arrangement. It is good for the farm business, but it also benefits the migrant worker. So moving away a little bit from that idea of the migrant worker being exploited, I guess. There is also, amongst some people, the fear that as we move away from the European Union, the UK has to engage with others, and the US in particular, and that may lead to what some people call an increasing neoliberalisation of the agri-food system. That we move away from state regulations, that we allow the market to regulate things, and we begin to enter negotiations and trade agreements with countries that maybe don't have the same levels of animal welfare protection as our own. And there's a bit of discussion in the UK at the moment in terms of imports of food and meat from the US, where different standards are used. So those are some of the negative aspects of Brexit that are being talked about by some of the people within our interviews. I want to finish off now by talking about some of the more positive issues that are being raised. First one is about fairness. Fairer agri-food system. Within the UK, within the European Union, we've had the Common Agricultural Policy, which provides particular subsidies to different groups of farmers and farm businesses. So there's an argument being made by some of the people involved in this research, that this is an opportunity now to move from a model that's been designed for the whole of the European Union to a model of public subsidy, farm subsidies, that works for the UK, and to be offering subsidies to smaller farmers as well as the big ones and the big landowners, and to be thinking about whether we should be offering public subsidy to very large landowners, very rich landowners, at a time when the government in the UK is struggling to pay for a variety of public services. So there are some debates about how we use public subsidy to support the agri-food sector. There are some interesting discussions now about using Brexit to think about how we design a agri-food system that meets the needs of the people of the UK, that addresses issues of food security, of food sovereignty, that thinks about the food system in national terms rather than internationally, that tries to localise some of these concerns to do with food. So as this person says, trying to turn the the sovereignty discourse, putting Britain first, into something positive in terms of a different type of food system. Trying to get people to engage with food, to understand where food comes from, to perhaps think beyond the supermarket, the imported mass-produced food, to re-engage with those people farming in their regions and in their localities. And to try and think more politically about food, to think about food much more as a political issue. And that issue of politics also connects with a developing body of literature and a developing movement in the UK which is focused on the idea of food justice. It's an idea that comes out of the United States, but it's trying to do two things really. One, to provide a critique of the global food system, the global conventional industrial neoliberal food system, to think critically about that system, and in parallel to think about the possibilities of alternative systems, which are much more focused on local sets of issues. So it's about bringing more equity into the system in terms of how food is distributed, but also in terms of who makes the decisions about the food system within the UK and further afield. And it's trying to address sets of social issues as well as issues to do with food itself. And at its heart is the idea that food is extremely important to us within our everyday lives. It's something we have to consume, so let's take it a little bit more seriously. Why food justice for me is important is because if we go back many, many years, if we go back to previous centuries, we find that the same sort of issues that we're talking about today are present in the past. That the farm worker has always been marginalised or exploited, never been well represented, never been really able to negotiate pay rises. They're always imposed on them. They're extremely compliant, as you can see there. The last strike in agriculture in the UK was in 1923. This acceptance of this situation has a long history to it, and perhaps we need to be rethinking these things in terms of taking a different approach to this set of issues. And so I think what Brexit enables us to do is to think about food in a more holistic way, to join different aspects of the food system up, to repoliticise food. So within the UK, and Andy's done a lot of work on this, there is a rising incidence of hunger, people not being able to afford appropriate nutritional food. At the same time as rising levels of hunger, rising levels of obesity within the UK. Interesting debates about fast and slow food, trying to think about the ethics of food, animal welfare, those sorts of issues. And as the price of food is rising at the moment, whether the UK population begins to accept higher food prices as something that is worth paying for a higher quality food system where workers within that system are paid fair wages. Brexit could also open up new ways of localising or relocalising the food system, shortening supply chains so we become less reliant on imports, celebrating, recognising, celebrating the seasonality of food, that we should be expecting certain types of food at particular times of the year, rather than expecting tomatoes to be in our supermarkets every month. And trying to reconnect people with food and with food within their regions and local areas. And finally, I think Brexit opens up new sets of relationships between the town and the country, the city and the country, urban and rural areas. The countryside of the UK has been heavily shaped by the European Union and by farm subsidies. We've got opportunities now to think about how we invest that money to develop, I guess, rural ecosystems and to develop landscapes. We've got new opportunities to think about food security and sustainability. And I think there are new opportunities available to look at the connections between the agriculture in the countryside and the growing movement to grow food within our cities. And in terms of urban agriculture, that is a very progressive agenda within the UK, where food growing is seen as important, is special, something to be celebrated, rather than this race to the bottom to produce lots and lots of food through industrial processes. So to finish, I think we're at a crossroads within the UK in terms of Brexit. There are particular groups who are pushing for the conventional model of agri-food, business as usual, an industrial food system, mass production, cheap food, heavy reliance on imported food, perhaps more trade agreements and a more neoliberal system, a continued reliance on low quality work, low wage work, and migrant workers. And interestingly, there's quite a bit of discussion going on within the UK agri-food system about the ways in which we can reduce costs even more by using robots and automation within the food system to pick particular crops. So we have that narrative, that way forward. But I would suggest that we also have some alternatives to also be calling for, discussing, exploring the ways in which we could create a new type of food system within the UK. That is about relocalisation or shortening supply chains. It's about paying higher wages to people within the sector. It's about getting people to see farming as a career rather than a seasonal job. It's about connecting people with food again, thinking about the ethics and the justice that are within that food system. Okay, thank you.
Still rolling? Are we still filming? Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Do you want to stop? Yeah. Okay. So, I guess we can have some discussion and then what was ending up.
In your opinion, Brexit is a good or bad initiative for you? In fact.
Personally, I voted to remain. I think probably a lot of people within the university sector voted to remain to maintain, if nothing else, these types of exchange visits.
This is funded through, we're here through Erasmus, which is funded by the European Commission. But we are where we are, and I think it's generally accepted by most of the political parties in the UK that the British people have voted, and therefore we need to try and develop a new relationship with Europe that works in our interests. The people who, I guess, were most vociferous about leaving were also on the right wing of the Conservative Party, and those people tend to favour free trade agreements, neoliberal policies, rather than state regulation, state protection. So there is that difficult issue there that the people who were pushing to leave are the people who probably favour that business as usual model of the agri-food system. But as I said before, we've got probably 21 months to settle all of this, to negotiate. We'll see how things develop. There is an awful lot of uncertainty. You hear about things being said privately, but things being said publicly that are a bit different. The current Prime Minister has restated that the target for migration is to reduce it to less than 100,000 people per year, and it is more than double that at the moment. So we will see whether that is possible.
Do you imagine what way the migration policy will go from current period, from Brexit? And do you mind, are any changes after Brexit announcement and all documents signed?
Well, what happens is this 2 year period is when the negotiations take place, and until we get to the end of that 2 year period, we won't know what will actually happen. But in terms of people within the agri-food system, they're making some rather big claims, big statements that, okay, if they can't guarantee the migrant workers coming into the UK, then they will take their production outside of the UK. So they will move to the Netherlands, to Spain, and to other countries to maintain production in those countries. Which then, interestingly, means that a higher proportion of UK food is imported. Is imported from other countries into the UK. Some of the people we talked to, particularly the unions, the trade unions, were talking about the ways in which certain companies now were using Brexit as an excuse to relocate their operations to cheaper places in Europe. So there's been a trend over the last few years of UK companies moving their operations outside of the UK to other places in Europe as the East and Central European Union countries have come in. One of the big things for the UK government at the moment is not guaranteeing that EU citizens can remain within the UK. And its argument for not doing that is it needs to know what the position is of UK citizens in other EU countries. So there are a lot of UK citizens in Spain, in France, for example. And so there's a negotiation going on in terms of whether UK citizens in other European countries will be able to remain, as well as citizens of other EU's countries being able to remain within the UK. So it is very, very difficult to answer that question because there's such a large degree of uncertainty at the moment. And it literally can change from week to week. The general election that is taking place on June the 8th within the UK, all the opinion polls are pointing to the Conservative Party having a much larger majority than it currently has. And one of the reasons why the Prime Minister has called a general election, it is claimed, is so that she can have a much bigger majority, which means that she can negotiate in particular ways with the European Commission.
One question. Can you reflect more about, I really like the last slide, like repoliticising the food system and pushing for fairer wages for rural workers, food workers in retail, in production. Can you reflect on the incompatibility between that and escalating rates of food poverty and deregulation of labour and welfare, which Brexit will bring in terms of it's going to race to the bottom and kind of the increased precarity for other workers? So is there this kind of discrepancy or partiality in food justice movement if we're pushing for higher wages, but and what happens to the other people?
Yeah, I mean, that's a very good question. Because you could argue, I think I made this point, that the types of things that are going on in terms of changing labour practices in the agri-food system are replicated elsewhere within the broader economy in terms of the sort of gig economy and piecemeal work and zero-hours contracts. And yeah, you're correct that we can't look at these issues outside of that broader context. And it may be that things can change in the way I'm proposing here in the food sector, but as you say, if that's not reflected in the broader economy, then things like hunger and food poverty are going to not only remain but become more significant. Now, interestingly, that £30 billion that's going into as subsidies to support the conventional system, there are no guarantees that it will all be spent on agriculture in a post-Brexit system. And there are some interesting debates going on at the moment to do with fairness, equity, justice. When we're cutting public services, and there are lots of debates in the UK about the underfunding of the public health service, how do we think about those sorts of issues and appropriate levels of funding for those public services relative to providing massive public subsidies to large landowners and major farmers within the UK. One of the reasons why there's a lot of discussion going on from the business as usual stakeholders to try and secure as big a slice of that money as they can get on hold of. So it may be that using those public subsidies that have gone into farming differently, maybe some of that money not going into farming into the future, or maybe more of it going into protection of landscapes and ecosystems, more of it going into support different types of farm businesses, may bring an element of justice, or more justice, more fairness into the system. But you're right, that's in that broader context of changes to the economy in the UK and changes to public services, austerity, and public sector cuts. And you can't look at one without the other.
Question about the Brexit wars. As I can hear from the presentation, the farmers, the growers, they suffer most significantly from Brexit. At the same time, the highest votes to leave, as I saw from the slides, were actually in the rural and agri-food areas. How do you explain this?
Well, it's a very very important irony that the farmers, the opinion polls on farmers showed that a majority voted to leave. Okay, and when we look at the geography of the vote, those areas that have benefited most from membership of the European Union voted strongest to leave. So those disadvantaged ex-industrial places that have received lots of regional assistance money from the European Commission to regenerate, to restart the economy, to provide lots of community support, those places were amongst the highest voting places to leave. And the same with the agricultural areas receiving the subsidies. I think people don't realise what they've done in those places. They voted on the basis of migration, because in both those types of places, in the disadvantaged towns and cities, and the agricultural areas, that was where a lot of migrant workers located too, in terms of the agricultural areas, because there was work there, in terms of the disadvantaged places, because that was where housing was cheapest, and they could afford to live within those places. It's an interesting question. And
maybe they just fed up with migrants, and the other reason they competition from the newcomers.
That was a very strong narrative that was presented. But as I showed from one of the slides, the migrant workers were doing the work that UK workers were no longer prepared to do. And in terms of the rising significance of migrant workers within the UK economy and within the agri-food system in the UK, it's no different to other countries. If you followed the US election debates last year, migrant workers were talked about in similar ways. Migrant workers from Mexico in particular, that they were part of the problem rather than the solution. That they were a group that could be moved back to Mexico rather than a group that was underpinning the conventional economy within the US, within the UK. And interestingly, in terms of migrant workers and securing new sources, new pools of migrant workers, some of the people we're talking to are talking about that the countries beyond the central and eastern European countries of the EU, Ukraine being one of them that is being talked about. So, as I said before, there is so much uncertainty, there are so many contradictions and tensions surrounding this vote, that it is difficult to know not what things will look like in 2 years, but what things will look like in 6 months, or indeed in a few weeks' time after the UK general election. So you could call it interesting
times in the UK at the moment.
Thank you.
Can I add to discussion? First of all, I much enjoyed the presentation and the way you put it. I think it highlighted a lot of dimensions in juxtaposition between them. Brexit, migration, food, justice, security, and so on and so forth. But, you know, we see how they all connected together. For me, it was interesting also to think about these things through my specialism more on that energy, right? And in energy, and this is related to Andy's question, actually, the dilemma between justice and hunger, and how justice for some people may mean problems for the other people, right? So what is actually then just in energy sector, we talk about trilemma, energy trilemma, right? We talk about how to resolve trilemma that energy needs to be affordable, just, sustainable, green, and energy security. So it needs to be security. So three elements: security, justice, and sustainability. This is what I very much see here, right? So it's a food trilemma. How you resolve these three blocks without compromising the other. And one of the main energies goes through things through distributed energy. Right? So bottom up, so community energies, or renewable energies, small scale installations. So this was one of the solutions. It looks like you are also talking about localized, sort of more distributed production of energy, food. And if we talk about energy, there's public subsidies to do that, right? So there's feed-in tariffs or all sorts of public subsidies. So do you see that there could be distributed justice in food, and I mean talking about urban-rural interface in particular? And whether the public sector needs somehow to support that through subsidies or some other form of support. Just to carry on, if I could, from the Russian experience, there was, of course, in the beginning of the 90s, a lot of economic problems related to transition. And one of the way how the government wanted to address the problems of hunger, or impending problems with hunger, they just gave land to urban communities in suburban areas or peri-urban areas, so that people produce their own food in a, what you may classify as a just ethical way. It was local food, organic food, in many respects, heavily based on manual labor by urban workers who spend their weekends doing this, growing that. I mean, to some extent, you can say that this is what your vision for a fair food system, but it was really a coping mechanism rather than something just in a way. But it was subsidizing this kind of model by the public sector by giving them land. So one of the ways. So do you think in the UK it could be some ways of addressing that?
I think so. Yes. So I talked about the ways in which subsidies could be used differently to reward particular types of food production. One of the fastest growing aspects of agriculture in the UK is urban agriculture, community gardening, community growing, people coming together in cities. Do that, but also in the countryside as well, in terms of some of the more community supported agriculture. And they are doing things in really interesting, exciting ways. So, a new approach to food, starting off with maybe issues of food security or food justice or food sustainability, looking to use organics, looking to provide value added through the food system. Using the food system to bring people together.
to create social benefit, community benefit, to provide new forms of political empowerment. They may require public subsidy. You could argue that they don't, or they won't require public subsidy, in that with austerity, with city councils facing big public sector cuts, the green space that exists within the city has a cost attached to it in terms of maintaining those spaces. There are groups out there who want to use those spaces to grow food in different ways. There could be a nice balancing there of local authorities, city councils that cannot afford to maintain those spaces, groups who are desperate for those spaces to do interesting things or different things in terms of growing food. And some people, including myself, have talked about the ways in which we need to bring food back into the city to create what we might see as edible cities, where things are grown not because they look nice and are good for tourists to look at, but are functioning as spaces of food production. So that, you know, on your way home from the office to your house, you can be picking herbs and fruit from plants and trees that are growing in public spaces within the city. Why do city planners not plant fruit trees in the centre of the city? All new trees in cities look like they do on in architect's plans, a particular type of tree. It's just thinking differently, it's thinking holistically, probably beyond the scope of this paper, about how we can re-engage with food, not just in the countryside, but in cities.
But I think it's an observation which is important, it's pollution, right? So in urban context, it's often that if you grow things, they are polluting.
Yeah, but it's, well, technically they're not actually. If you look at some of the technical papers, that's not necessarily the case. So a lot of the big community gardening initiatives are using raised beds, so new soil, rather than any polluted soil. But the bigger picture, and I'm hearing this is part of Moscow as well, is maybe we take the car out of the city for longer periods. So we need to think about cities in different sort of ways. When we think about previous decades, we don't have to go too far back to realise that growing food and selling food in the city was an integral part of being an urban resident. We go back to the Second World War in the UK. I'm sure it was the same in this country as it was in the UK and in the US, where the pressures on us in terms of not being able to import as much food, being at war, led to the production of new spaces within and beyond the city, the so-called Dig for Victory campaigns. So it's about reimagining the city in different ways and creating these new relationships between the city and the countryside in terms of food production and food consumption.
More questions for Paul? If you want, you can ask in Russian, you can translate. But maybe just then final question, related, because you started with Poland, Polish migrants, which apparently remarkably representing almost a million residents in the empire in 2015, probably now less than that. But do you have any idea? I don't know the research there, but probably you do. Why it's so ethnic centric in terms of Polish migrants, more specifically? Why, given that accession to 10 countries, why the Polish migrants are so overrepresented? And does it suggest anything about cultural, ethnical, lifestyles, or worldviews, or maybe habits of particular ethnicity? Because it was quite interesting before even Poland came to become a new country. I remember I have Polish friends, and it was an interesting model when you see, for instance, buses going from local Polish towns, not Warsaw, not Krakow, but some smaller ones, going directly to places like Oxford or, quite an interesting link. And then they use these buses and they come to those cities, not only London, but also smaller cities, and they already had a network of people who would organize everything. So even because before legality of being a EU citizen working in the UK, so it was illegal really. So they came, there would be a person who distributed them to different roles. It was really well organized as a system. And so I was really impressed by this method. So looking at the Polish communities, they are quite actually, you presented that they are isolated from the local communities, but Polish
in that particular sector, beyond that.
But Polish communities themselves, they are very coherent within. So this is like Chinese communities. So they are very networked within the UK. So you can see Polish shops everywhere. You can see how the just really a sense of community supporting each other, which may be one of the coping mechanisms also being in a precarious situation. So I guess there's a specific ethnical cultural dimensions there, which are quite interesting if you think about that. But maybe you know more about this kind of...
No, I think you've probably answered your own question there. I think it probably was because they were existing networks available. I think there were certain labour suppliers who went into Poland to encourage people to move. It was when I did an earlier project on Polish migrant workers, the first groups to come across, as is usual with migration, were young single male workers, and then the word went out that there was work to be gained in the UK, and families started to move across. There was existing sort of structural things that were there, so the bus was one. What we found with some of our work was exactly what you said, that a number of people from a particular place in Poland were coming to a particular place in the UK.
Right.
So you have international migration, but the same group from one place, the same group in another place. And that connection that you talked about being there. There are other groups from the EU aid that you can find in the UK. But why so many more Polish migrants? I'm not quite sure. I mean, there is a historical connection between the UK and Poland in terms of the Second World War, and there was an existing Polish community in the UK in the
immediate period after the Second World War, but I think for the reasons that you've mentioned, those would be the ones that have meant that the Polish workers are predominantly. What is interesting now is looking at those figures, new sets of figures, to see how many people are going home, how many people are coming to the UK to work. So we get the next set of figures, we know how Brexit is going to impact on those people who are here and those people who may have come in the past.
It's very interesting. Britain was instrumental for the Polish accession, for the accession to the EU, and then it became as a fact of Brexit, which is leaving the EU.
He did, although the UK government underestimated the number of Polish workers that came across. I think that was part of the problem. So most of the other EU countries put restrictions on how many could come across. The UK didn't do that for a set of economic reasons, I guess. That then has come back to hit them in the face politically in terms of the vote.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So, yeah, maybe you introduce the next
speaker. Well, okay.
Choose a little bit there, and then I can put it right.